Okay, and welcome to the last session of the first day. Hope you had a great time, and yeah, we promise more of that tomorrow. Tomorrow we will start with the registration at 8:30, so there's a slight difference between today and tomorrow. And I hope that those of you who came by car today have learned the lesson to not repeat that tomorrow and use the public transportation, because a lot of people have been late on the registration and first talk because they were circling around. So yeah, if you can, use the GSP. Okay, so Giulia is here and she will give the final keynote of the first day. It's a fantastic blend of psychology and technology. So yeah, thank you.
Thank you for the introduction. Thank you. Oh, wow. Well, this is more of a welcome than I expected, so thank you for sticking around. My name is Giulia. I am currently a director of customer acquisition for a global marketplace. And on the side, I got a small neuromarketing consultancy. So today I'm here to represent one of those departments you might not work with very often. So my background is in neuroscience. So for those of you who are not familiar with it, neuroscience is the study of the brain and the nervous system in the attempt of better understanding the behind the scenes of how humans behave and think. So it's made up of several different fields, subfields that are all interconnected and use different methodology to look into different aspects of brain functioning. So obviously now I'm in marketing. And the way that I started in marketing was by getting into SEO, search engine optimization. As of yesterday, The Verge came out with an article saying that we're the worst people on the planet, basically, because we ruined the internet, because they think that we just game the results and make people click on whatever results they don't want to click on. I think it's giving us a bit more credit than we deserve, really. But when I started in SEO, I was really confused because I kept hearing at the very beginning that content needed to be the focus of everything. We needed to have content that had the right keyword density. We needed to have more content than our competitors as well to perform better on search engines. Then an algorithm update hit and the focus became on technical. So by technical, what I mean is we needed to fix the 404 pages, or we needed to fix any other sort of architectural problem that was on the website. And finally this year, what are we all talking about? AI. So my team and all of the other teams are all talking about ways to leverage AI in order to optimize our website for search engines. But again, when I started, and even today, I'm really confused because we're missing one major point, which is we're not only optimizing for the search engines, we're optimizing for our main stakeholder, which is the user. Users that are real people, users that make decisions all the time and that have needs to be fulfilled. So if you think about it, you're always making decisions as well. Some of these decisions are more overt, and some of these other decisions are a bit more implicit. So for example, today you decided to show up at the conference, you decided what to wear, hopefully not in this order, and then you decided to have breakfast, for example. But other decisions are a bit more covert. So right now you might be deciding to pay attention to my words or to my slides, or maybe something else, like your phone, for example. So the basic understanding of how humans make decisions is quite beneficial in our job as marketers and in our collaboration with other teams as well. And Google has been very vocal about that as well. The user is the focus of all of the algorithms that they push out in the last probably few months now. And by the end of this talk, hopefully we will have learned to put the user back in focus, but also how to win their attention. Because obviously, we always want to rank first. As marketers and as SEOs, we always want the first result because that's the one that gets more clicks. However, if all of the results look the same, it's very hard for the user to discriminate which one they would click on. And right now, there's so much that's changing within the landscape that we need to make sure we connect with them at a deeper level. And finally, we're going to see how we can increase the engagement and how we can become that brand that they keep on coming back to when they need that something that we can provide. So we're going to embark on this journey through the customer funnel. For simplicity, I'm going to go very linearly. So from like awareness until the customer acquisition. However, bear in mind that the journey can be sometimes a bit more winding, like in this image. And because we needed to speak a common language, I decided to do so via Jira tickets. So hopefully, you'll have a nice ride with me through the end of the day. So starting from the very start, the very first item on the funnel is the awareness phase. It's when we want to gather the user's attention so that we can get their visit onto our website. And this is a stage where, you know, a lot can happen. And one of the tickets that I put up for my engineering team at the time was, OK, let's test emojis. How can we include emojis in titles and meta descriptions to increase CTRs? That didn't go through. Estimating the ROI of something like that is quite difficult if you don't have a previous test. So, you know, when things have to move up from the backlog, it's quite difficult to justify. But this is because at the very early stages of the journey, obviously the user is bombarded with a lot of stimuli when they're inputting a search. They get all of these results that potentially they're looking very similar. And they don't really have all of the resources, the attentive resources, to allocate to one of them, unless there's something that captures their attention. And it might be feeling a bit overwhelming to discriminate between all of those results. So we don't even realize it, probably, but in the real world, we have a parallel in everyday life for this competition for attention, which is, just right now, for example, we are continuously hit by a number of stimuli that are all potentially competing for our attention. For example, sounds, visual stimuli, and so on. So the way that we discriminate some of these and we bring them back into processing is by a process called selective attention. So we discard some of these stimuli as noise, and we just bring back into processing something else that's more relevant to us. There's different mechanisms that trigger attentional shifts. Some of these are internal factors. So for example, when I'm really motivated to finish a task because I got a deadline, so I know to focus on one thing. There's cognitive biases as well that can impact the way that we process information. And finally, external factors, which are the mere perceptual features of the object, so the physical features. There is, for example, you know, when you're doing a task, but there is, I don't know, the fire alarm goes off. So that's something that captures our attention for the perceptual features. There is actually something else that's part of this realm, which is the relevance of something to our own domain. So for example, there's this great example called the cocktail party effect, which explains how we react with an attentional shift when the stimulus is particularly relevant to us. So for example, you're later at the after party. You're talking with a friend that you haven't caught up with in a long time, or a new friend. So you're very engaged in the conversation. And suddenly, somebody mentions your name at the back of the room. So your attention will automatically go to that source of, you know, of information because they mentioned your name. It's a stimulus that's particularly relevant for you, and your friend probably will not even react to that. And this doesn't only go for something that's, you know, particular to us, like our name. It goes for what's relevant to the context as well, which is the entire reason why marketers want to be relevant, because we react to what's relevant to the context, like a keyword. And I'm not here to tell you to be relevant, because I think by now we know that to get the user's attention, we need to be relevant. But I'm here to talk about all of the things or the common grounds that we didn't know we had, which are all of the stimuli that we react to with an attentional shift, even though our background change, even though our names are different. So we got all of these common brain activation patterns called ERP that are related to certain stimuli. So one of these, for example, is the N170. These are event-related potentials that have been isolated in EEG studies. So they show us brainwaves, basically. One of these is the N170, which is a negative deflection, which happens at 170 milliseconds from the presentation of faces. But not only biological faces, also to face-like configurations. So I think you know now where I'm going, because we talked about emojis before. That was the entire reason why I put up that ticket. Emojis capture the attention and can be a gold mine for from the very early stages of the journey. And actually, they elicit even a more negative response or a more pronounced response than biological faces, which is quite telling of where we're going as a society. But yeah, so if you look at these results, for example, the attention of the user will go straight to those results that include a face. And somebody actually tested this. It was on a small-scale website, so I need to make a caveat here, which is Google will take them out if they don't deem them relevant to the query or your brand. But it seemed to work for Simone De Palma, who's a contact of mine. I was really happy to see this, because then I could include it. But not only on organic results. This goes for example, Google Business Profile posts as well. Sterling Sky showed double the CTRs for posts that included an emoji. So we talked about emojis in the face sense, but there's also emojis that are not really those, you know, smiley pictures. There's also these ones like the flag. So these sort of like these items can trigger up to 250 more CTRs, and that's because of another ERP, which is the mismatch negativity. The mismatch negativity is another pattern of activation which is common to a lot of humans, and it's observed in relation to the violation of expectancy. So we react with this deflection whenever we are presented with a stimulus we don't expect. It can be shown in the auditory domain or in the visual domain. And this comes quite early on because it's at the early stages of processing. Like, for example, when I spot a no in all of those L's. But the important part is that it shows also semantically. And it's a later ERP. It shows up 400 milliseconds after the presentation of a stimulus. Like in this case, this was a study that isolated the N400, as it's been called, to show the semantic impact of a contextual change. So participants were presented with three sentences. It was basically three different variants of the same sentence. One said, he spread the warm bread with butter. The other sentence was, he spread the warm bread with butter, but with capitalized butter. And then the third variant was the one with the semantic change, which was, he spread the warm bread with socks. So, I mean, I don't know about your habits, but a lot of the participants obviously showed a negative deflection that was related to the contextual change. So, again, what I always recommend is to try to use this in your favor. So if there's like bolding or special characters or, you know, something that's contextually wrong, it will be something that captures the attention, because the element of surprise ensures that attentional shift, whether it's a perceptual or a semantic one. So at this point, say that you nailed, you know, the first part. Your first task was to get the visit of the user. So the user visits your website, and now it's the part where they have to consume the content on the website. And this is a part where cognitive biases might come into play in the information processing. So cognitive biases, by definition, are considered systematic errors in thinking that affect the way not only that we process information and interpret it, but also the way that we make judgments. And one of the tickets that I brought up to sort of tap into one of these biases was to move the content of one of our pages, or like a set of pages, from the middle of the page up to the top. And this was also based on the fact that Google had put an algorithm out saying that, you know, important content needed to be above the fold. But I was also tapping into something else, which was the serial position effect. The serial position effect states that given a list of words, we're more prone to remember the ones that are presented first and last. So it's made up of these two sub-effects, primacy and recency effect. This has got a, this not only has an impact on the way that we process information or we process words, but also in the way that we see, you know, contextual information within the page. For example, this is a the primacy effect is at the base of anchoring, which is when we make a judgment based on the first information we are provided with to evaluate all of the other options. Say, in this case, I got a £50 budget to buy an air fryer, but the first one that I'm presented with is the more expensive one. So my brain will think that that's the one that I need to evaluate all of the other ones against. And it will think that, you know, air fryers are expensive. So that what makes me feel more comfortable getting something that's a bit out of my budget, but it's still something in between. It's not the extreme, because that's another bias that we have as humans. We tend to stay away from extremes, and we tend to go for the middle option when given the chance. So now we're talking about pricing, and there's something else when evaluating prices that comes into play, which are numerical biases. There's two that have been isolated that are quite interesting. They're called the distance and size effect. The distance effect states that given two numbers, we're much faster and accurate at estimating which one is larger if the distance between them is bigger. And the size effect says that the same task is faster if the size of the numbers, if the size is small. So if they're small numbers as compared to large numbers. And this has got to do with theories on the way that we imagine numbers in our mind. So there's theories on the mental number line. And in both cases, what you need to remember is that judging differences becomes harder when bigger numbers are involved. So in this case, it means that it's much faster for a user to evaluate a saving price that's expressed in fractions or in percentages, for example, as compared to something with an integer number. And that's the reason why a lot of marketers and, like, you know, marketing gurus will tell you, use the bigger number because that will drive more people to you. Sure, but you're also tricking the user, and you might fall victim of yet another bias, which is the negativity bias. So if brands trick their users, you know, users are not stupid. They will remember that, and they will not come back to you. Because as humans, we tend to have this over-attention to the negative side of things as compared to the positive or neutral counterpart. And that's something that has been shown to affect, you know, not only the way that we make judgments in the real world, but also it makes an impact on the way that we process information online. So it has to do with, like, bigger CTRs or, like, higher CTRs for negative headlines as compared to positive ones. And media exploit that a lot. That's basically why clickbait was born, because they know that we have this overattention that was born as an evolutionary mechanism, really. You know, we needed as humans to be more careful to threats because it was useful for our species to survive. However, in non-threatening situations, we still display this, even at the neural level. And this is important for us and for cross-functional teams, because when the user has spent already time on your website, they might encounter a pain point. And if they're not, you know, they're not able to solve that, they will remember that. And they might abandon the website altogether. So this was another ticket. Didn't make it. 404 pages redesign. I wanted to provide a way for users to be redirected. And that was based off this study as well, which was from 2023 by Baymard. And a lot of the pain points that are very easily solvable by us make up to 50% of the reasons why users abandon at the checkout level, which is when they spent already so much energy going through your content, your offers, and they're potentially looking to convert. So the final one that we're going to see for this one, for this part of cognitive biases, is the confirmation bias. So the confirmation bias is an interesting one, and I think it's one that we're all familiar with. We're more prone to favor information that confirms our existing belief. And this also affects perception. There was this great study, an fMRI study, on Coca-Cola versus Pepsi, which showed that not only, like, mislabeling them would change the preference when users were, or, like, when participants were reporting their preferences, but even overrode the preference at the neural level. So it's a very potent bias. And so to better understand this in the context of search, I wanted to bring up this example, which is an older one, because it's traveling just post-pandemic. But it can be quite clear, the confirmation bias can be quite clear in the way that we see users formulating their queries to get to a website. So after the pandemic, obviously a lot of people wanted to travel again, right? So the queries for travel-related websites went up a lot. And one of these is, for example, is Expedia Legit. No shade to Expedia, because Expedia is great, but a lot of other brands show the same pattern, even like marketplaces. So one of the things that was problematic with that is that Expedia didn't rank anywhere on page one or two for that query, because obviously, as a lot of brands, they think, you know what, obviously we're legit. Our customers know that we're legit. But here, you're dealing with people that are not familiar with your brand because they came to your website, they're evaluating your offers, but you're not giving them the authoritative content to finish that transaction. So the problem with not ranking anywhere there was that, you know, somebody else coming to the website and looking for that query would have to rely on somebody else's information. And the way that they counted the search rate, the existing belief that they bring to the search would have determined if they were gonna believe the positive opinion more, or if they were gonna believe the other opinion more. Obviously, when there's an authoritative source in the mix, then it's a safe bet. But we've seen that the negativity bias is quite potent one. So obviously, in case there's any uncertainty, it's likely that the user will abandon there if you're not providing them with the proactive addressing of their concerns. This was an example, again, of how we tapped into the confirmation bias, because as I mentioned, like, you can see a lot of confirmation bias from the way the users formulate their queries. This was a client of mine. So up to, is it 129,000 searches a month went towards branded searches that we were not doing very well for. Click-through rates were not great. And these were all information that we could provide because it was, you know, are we legit, actually? Where are we based? Is shipping to this country possible? So, yeah, these were all of the missed opportunities. However, we did tap into that. We added schema markup to make it more relevant from the very early stages of search, and that went through. So this was a success story. You can see that the FAQ searches went up, and like we got more clicks from it until Google decided that they were not relevant anymore. They altogether, they took out the FAQs. So yeah, tough luck. So at this stage, we're entering the phase we talked about, you know, cognitive biases and a lot of the implicit decisions that go on behind the scenes. However, we haven't talked about the more overt decisions yet, which is when, you know, we're evaluating offers on the website, for example. So in terms of decision making, I'm really bad. This is a full disclosure. I went to another conference once. This was a marketing conference. It's quite famous in the UK. And they gave away free t-shirts. And one of them was the one you see in the picture. One of them was another one. I think it was like blue and whatever. So I stayed at the stand choosing which one to get, probably 15 minutes. And the lady at the stand was like so over me. She was trying to convince me. And she was like, look, this one is the most collectible. This is the one that people will not find next year because it's a limited edition. And really, if you really want to change it, at the end of the day, you can. So you can bring it back. So I was sold. And that's because I use mental shortcuts to get to making that decision. We saw that we don't have the cognitive resources that, you know, that we can use to evaluate all of the potential outcomes of a choice. So we tend to rely on these shortcuts. We tend to rely on mental schemes that allow us to make decisions, especially in a faster time. So they're basically our rule of thumb. And some of these heuristics that we can use in marketing and that we can make more prominent in messaging are, for example, the availability heuristic, which is when we tend to favor information that's more available in our mind. So this is based on how recent a piece of information is, how many times we've heard of it, or even like if something is particularly vivid, it's got an emotional an emotional attachment to it. For example, if I need to send a parcel over, and there's two brands that I can choose between, but one of them has been in the news recently because they lost parcels, I will tend to go for the other one, although the probability of that happening to me is much lower than I expect, because especially because if something's been on the news for, you know, mismanagement, they will try to fix it and they will try to make it right. But because that's more available in my mind, then it's more prominent. And the same goes for when we recommend something to people. We might not recommend the best ever thing, but something that's readily available in our mind. So this is the reason why, for example, I advocate for cross-functional efforts and omnichannel strategies, because we don't need to be, we can't be only on organic, we need to be on paid, we need to use, you know, other marketing channels, and we need to make the messaging more prominent than ever. The scarcity heuristic is another one. How many of you have seen Emily in Paris? Because otherwise I'm missing the mark here. Okay, I've seen one, two, thank you, three. Okay, so there's this episode where she tries to explain it to somebody else, and then she gets told off, really, because it's quite basic. But that's a fundamental one that we react to, which is when, you know, we place more information, we place more value to something that's perceived as scarce or running out or limited edition. And again, this is something that's exploited. So while I say to my teams, look, you should make the messaging clear and, you know, loud from the very early start of the journey, it's also important that you don't trick the user. Like, if it's not true, don't put it there, because they will find out. Another one is the risk aversion heuristic. This is a mental scheme that states that given two options with similar returns, we tend to go for the one that presents the less amount of risks. Because we want to feel safe. That's the entire thing with us humans. So for example, we protect our trips, we get the free returns, or we get the payment in separate options rather than all up front, even if they might not have a discount. So again, something important for marketing here is to make it available in search already, because these are things that you can leverage from, you know, organic, but also in paid and throughout the website, throughout the journey. And finally, the familiarity heuristic, which is, you know, we just go for what we know already. I seem to understand this is not the first pasta example you hear today, so here's another one. I'm Italian, so we just love carbs. So given two brands of pasta, I will always go for the Italian one, not for the English one, sorry. Because that's what I know best, because that's what saves me all of the intermediate steps of deciding. If something's worked before, I'm just going to stick to that. And this doesn't have to do only with, you know, big brands versus small brands, because otherwise, small players wouldn't have a chance. It goes for the way that we tackle localization as well. When we go international, and a lot of brands don't get this right, they try to do it all, but they fail somehow. In some places. For example, here I'm on an Italian website, but the pop-up is in English. Sometimes I would have the filters in English instead. If I'm Italian, I kind of react to that because I'm like, it doesn't really speak my language. It's not relatable. So how do I do this? We're going to talk about familiarity as well later on as well. But at this point, I feel like it's important to make a point, because we talked about, you know, mental shortcuts and cognitive biases and so on. But there's this model called elaboration likelihood model, which is an old one, but it's still relevant in this instance, which says that, you know, when we talk about persuasion, the level of investment of the person being persuaded will determine if their decision is going to be based off the quantity or quality of the arguments. So obviously, when we're, you know, just users looking on Google for something, our investment is quite low. We're investing time and we're investing attention, but we're not making a bigger commitment. So at that point, we're more reliant on cognitive biases and heuristics. We're trying to cut corners and to save time. However, the more you get invested into the journey, the more you will put an attention on the quality of what the website has to offer. So that's the reason why I feel like it's important to point it out, because you can't only do t- tips and tricks to get the user. You need to actually provide great content. You need to provide great quality, great customer service, and a great product. And finally, there's something that really seals the deal when it comes to making an order, which is social proof. So that's another one that I made onto the onto my list of to-dos for Jira. It's still in development, so I'm hopeful. But the reason why I brought it up is the KFC Crocs, which I understand it's a logical jump here. But how many of you like this? Like, no judgment, by the way. Okay, I don't see many. I mean, I might be blind, but I don't see many. Okay, I see one. Fine. So a lot of people liked it, a lot. They went out in no time. So obviously, if today all of you walked in with the KFC Crocs, probably I would look into them as well, because I would want to be part of the gang. And that's because the brain is socially wired. What I mean by that is that we display the same pattern of activations as somebody else that we're observing when they're performing an action. So we have a natural tendency to imitate, which becomes a natural tendency to respond with a complementary action if we're presented with social cues. So this was a study that comes from the university. This was actually my graduation study, so I'm really proud. But we noticed how with TMS, transcranial magnetic stimulation, and the study of motor evoked potential, we could isolate this sort of complementary switch from an imitative behavior. So participants were watching a video while we were recording their brain activity. And when the actor was performing an action like grabbing a mug, the same pattern of activation was observed in our participants. However, when the actor was reaching out towards them, the pattern of activation was different. It was a complementary action, not the same action. So it was really interesting because it was really telling of our need as human beings to be social. The same goes for eye tracking studies in marketing that have shown how we are more sensitive to gaze, we're more prone to go for brands that show faces. And if the person in the creative is looking somewhere else, we tend to follow because we display patterns of shared attention. That's what causes the bandwagon effect, for example, and conformative behavior, which can be observed even in fish. So it's very, very back in very far in evolution, really. If you place one single fish in a tank with two different groups of fish of different magnitude, they will swim to the one, to the most numerous group, which also means that they can count, which is scary. But yeah, so we do the same. We, you know, when we have two options that are very similar, we tend to go for the one that has the most reviews because we want to feel safe in our choice. We need somebody to validate that. That's the reason why I'm like, please, please, please put the reviews up. We need them. And not only reviews, user-generated content is vital at this point because we're having to do with the new generations of Gen Zs and millennials that are very, very reliant on somebody else's opinion. Some of them, as you see from this study, the majority of them won't even consider transacting if there's not a review. And if there's not user-generated content, they won't even consider, like, they consider the brand not even to be legit. Gen Zs in particular are the toughest crowd because now they don't even like want to see ads. So if you're trying to do your strategy to trick them into, you know, like having these influencers saying that your product is the best, they will recognize that and they will skip it. They rely a lot on organic opinions. And that's the reason why Reddit, for example, has got the most organic traffic, or like 45%, I think, of their organic traffic is brands plus Reddit. That's their entire, almost, you know, half of their old traffic. So going back to Google, Google has always been very, recently been very vocal about that too. We used to have, I don't know how many of you are familiar with that, but we used to have quality guidelines, which was which were summarized in an acronym, EAT, standing for expertise, authority, and trust. So the content needed to have those 3 points in order to be considered valuable and rank better. Now they added the last E, which is for experience. The content now needs to be, you know, needs to sound like somebody actually purchased the product, like somebody, you know, that's reviewing a particular destination has actually been there. And they've also added up perspective filters. I think this is live only in the US for the time being. But again, this is like very, this is making organic content more prominent from the very early stage of the customer journey. There was this other content experiment that was super well designed. If you're into it, I urge you to take a look. And that was by Reboot. They studied how rankings were systematically better for human written content rather than AI content, because obviously when AI or like when ChatGPT came up, everyone was doing like all kind of content and like putting content up a scale, because it takes time, you know, to curate content. But still, the human factor is still what sets us apart. And not only, you know, the human factor is something that stands out from the competition, but it's also something that's quite vital to have the user to convert and to commit. Another study that I found, I think this was 2 days ago, so it was a very lucky find, but it showed how when a chatbot looks more human and when they're directly looking at you, users are more prone to commit with a brand and their perception is more positive to the brand. So we're tying it all up now with the role of emotions about, you know, in the entire customer journey, which is something that encompasses all of the stages that we've seen so far. So I was listening to a podcast on the plane here, and it was quite dark because it was about, you know, cult leaders. But basically there was this, you know, this cult person or like person involved in a cult, and their family tried to get them out with an intervention. And something that they said stuck with me, because they said their evidence, you know, their academic evidence wasn't enough for me to get out because the attachment to the group was emotional. So this is something that was, you know, really stuck with me because it was telling of this other sentence that I've heard somewhere and I put in the deck straight after, which was people make decisions emotionally and then they justify them rationally. We are thought to have 6 basic emotions. Now, theories on emotions have evolved since then. So this was from Paul Ekman in the 90s. But I think this is a model that is still quite relevant to understand how we can, you know, connect with the users at different stages in different ways. We're thought to have these universal emotions, which are happiness, sadness, fear, anger, surprise, and disgust. If you have watched Inside Out by Disney, Pixar, I think, then you will know that, except there's one emotion less in there. But these are the strings that we can play to connect, really, with our users. And the reason why we want to connect at an emotional level is because emotions are guiding decisions, especially when these decisions need to be made very fast. Think about the fight or flight response, for example. This is something that really fascinated me because, you know, when I came across these studies, I was looking into familiarity. And we spoke about the familiarity heuristic already and how it allows us to save resources in order to make decisions. But not only that, we go for what's familiar because what's familiar has got its own somatic marker. We react to familiar stimuli with a skin conductance response that's indicative of psychological arousal. And that's not only for familiar stimuli that we remember. This shows also when the familiar stimuli is denied, like when the participant says, I've never seen this before. But skin conductance doesn't lie. And this is another study on skin conductance responses. So basically, this shows how, sure, familiar brands or familiar stimuli elicit a skin conductance response, but more so negative stimuli do that. So that's the reason why I was talking about the negativity bias and the importance of solving those pain points for the customers, because even though familiar stimuli or positive emotions elicit this sort of highway to the customer's mind, we need to make sure that it doesn't get overridden by the negative. So for example, I love this example from TripAdvisor. I don't know if that's still like that. But they make me smile because I'm like, okay, well, we don't have this page, but you should be on holiday as well. And here's the ways that they redirect me somewhere else. And these positive experiences are really great because they have shown to correlate with the perceived brand authenticity, safety, and trust, which is vital in our journey to become the brand that everyone wants to go back to. So I always like to end on this one tweet, which is, fellas, don't be afraid to chase a girl if she's got a boyfriend. If she's single, you're competing with 20 other guys. If she's dating somebody, you're only competing with one. I got my reserves on that. Let me tell you why. I mean, imagine whether we were talking about a boyfriend or whether we're talking about a brand, if you have spent time, you know, creating memories and getting to know somebody and getting to know their flaws and maybe overcoming them, do you really think that the first rando that comes along will have the very same competition? We're emotional creatures after all, and we need that sort of emotional connection to make decisions. So you need to know what your users, how your users decide, but also what they need so that you can provide it to them. So in the end, what do you need to remember? Well, first thing is that you shouldn't be doing everything that your competitors are doing. A lot of the times I get challenged on my tickets because they're like, well, our competitors are not doing so. Exactly. We need to stand out because that's the only way that we can gather the customer's attention before they even interact with us. Secondly, please, please, please don't work in silos. Try to work cross-functionally, because now it's not only about, you know, the one KPI that every team has. We need to bring customers together in the entire journey. And finally, whatever you do, don't lose the human touch. That's the one thing that we still have an edge over AI for now. I don't know about next year. But the perception of safety is something that AI can still not replicate. And users do want to, you know, trust you and feel safe. So make it easy for them. Make sure that you address their concerns. Make sure that they have a place to make decisions. That's something that responds to their needs. And that was me. If you liked it, hated it, or if you have any comments, feel free to get in touch. And I'll be around for questions after here. So thank you.